Listening Library presents Hide and Geek by T.P. Jagger. Read for you by Denise Cabanela. For Amy, because you said yes.
Prologue.
Okay, by now, I'm sure you've heard about everything going on in the tiny town of Elmwood, New Hampshire, tucked away in the scenic Fair Valley. You've read the headlines or seen the photos or whatever. The failing factory, the hidden fortune, the kidnappings, all that stuff. Last week, a reporter showed up all the way from Australia to get the scoop. Unfortunately, except for his cool accent, he was like every other person who's flooded into Elmwood lately, chasing a fairy tale. But me? I grew up in Elmwood, and I care about the facts. So before you judge me for not looking like a journalist, consider this. Fact number one. Girls usually have their growth spurts between 10 and 14 years old. Fact number two. I'm only 11, so I have another 3 years. I could totally grow past 4'6" any day now. Anyway, I may be a short, freckle-faced 11-year-old, but I'm here to set the record straight. To take a stand for truth. After all, I'm not simply reporting what I think happened in Elmwood. I'm Gina Sparks, soon to be world-famous journalist, and I was there. I lived through it. Barely. And facts are what saved my life. Well, facts plus one little lie about Mark Twain. I realize you kind of already know how the story ends. At least you think you do. But as with all good stories, the best place to start is at the beginning. Or, if not quite at the beginning, at least at the part of the story where someone dies. The Elmwood Tribune, Friday, August 20th. Lass Van Houten in Elmwood found dead in rocking chair, by Gina Sparks, first draft. No paintball attacks have been reported on Scrubstone Lane since local recluse Alice Van Houten passed away recently at the age of 94.
Note, this is a clear and catchy lead, Gina Bean. Good job.
Although the exact time of her death is unknown, her body was discovered on Wednesday, August 18th by mailman Frank Nubbins. Mr. Nubbins spotted Miss Van Houten seated peacefully in her rocking chair on the front porch of Van Houten Manor. When she failed to yell at him or fire paintballs to chase him off her property, he decided to investigate. The classic Van Houten Bazooka Boom Painter 2000 on Miss Van Houten's lap was still loaded with a neon orange paintball grenade. Police Chief Luis Hernandez has confirmed that the cause of Miss Van Houten's death was simply being a really old lady. Miss Van Houten was the eldest and last surviving child of famous local toymaker Maxine Van Houten. As a female pioneer in both engineering design and business, Maxine was best known for inventing the internationally acclaimed 3D puzzle, the Bamboozler, produced by her Van Houten Toy and Game Company. Of course, Maxine was also known for her public promises to leave the bulk of her fortune to the town of Elmwood. That ended up being a total lie.
Note, remove that line.
However, after Maxine's death, the Van Houten fortune was never given to the town. Instead, it disappeared. It is believed that Maxine's frequent, unexplained absences from Elmwood prior to her death may have been for secret trips to Foxwoods Casino, where she is thought to have squandered her fortune on bingo. Ever since Maxine's death on April 3, 1987, her greedy children, scratch greedy, have neglected, scratch neglected, turned their attentions away from their mother's company, eventually selling off the Bamboozler to a rival company, gutting our great town's heart and crushing, scratch that, seriously affecting the local economy. Miss Alice Van Houten spent the last few decades alone on the family's estate. It is rumored that the peculiar crashing and banging noises often reported by locals passing the now crumbling manor were in fact Miss Van Houten searching futilely for her mother's lost fortune and going a bit batty in the process.
Note, Change that to losing touch with reality in the process. If these rumors are true, they kind of served Miss Van Houten right, considering the way her family treated our town. Note, be nice, Bean. Please do not include that last sentence. Miss Van Houten was preceded in death by her parents, Maxine and Harold Van Houten, younger siblings Cynthia Van Houten and Harold Van Houten Jr., and five different cats, Otis, 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 and Otis. She is survived by her nephew, Maxwell Van Houten, and by her 14-year-old tortoiseshell cat, Otis. If you are interested in becoming the caretaker for a grumpy old cat that constantly hacks up hairballs,
Bean?
Mature cat with special dietary needs, please contact the Van Houten Estate, care of Mr. Thomas Ridley, attorney at law. A 2-month supply of Feline Queen Salmon Supreme Hairball Control canned cat food is included. No public memorial service will be held for Miss Van Houten, and the fate of Van Houten Manor is not yet known.
Note, this is a good first draft, Bean. But don't let your personal connection to the news interfere with your ability to report without bias. Remember, a reporter must remain objective, even if she has strong feelings about her subject. Mom.
Chapter 1. I may not be a math genius like my friend Kevin, but I can count. And because I'm a journalist, it's important for me to record things accurately. Which is why I always keep a pencil tucked into my bun and carry my scuffed-up leather notebook. It's vintage, a birthday gift from Mom last year. So when Kevin popped from his lunchroom seat like a jack-in-the-box, I knew it was the 27th time he'd done that in only 8 minutes. "Kevin Robinson for president. Be sure to vote," Kevin blurted. He snatched a Kevin for 6th grade class president flyer from the massive stack in the middle of our lunch table and thrust it toward Gunnar Bradley, who nearly dropped his lunch tray in surprise. "Scientific calculators for every student and new science lab equipment. More funding for the debate team and educational field trips. Help me help you make Elmwood Middle School a better place to learn." Instead of the outstretched flyer, Gunnar snatched a chicken nugget from Kevin's lunch and said,
"Thanks, dude. Chicken nuggets rule."
As Gunnar hustled away, I glanced across the lunch table at my other two best friends, Edgar Feingarten and Elena Hernandez. Elena and I shared an eye roll. Kevin had been class president in 3rd grade, in 4th grade, and in 5th. Of course he'd be class president again in 6th grade. Nobody else ever bothered to run against him. Plus, he was the one who'd started the school's peer tutoring program, raised money for new sports equipment with a car wash, and got the cafeteria to turn the smelly lunch scraps into compost for the school garden. He had good ideas, and everyone knew it. Kevin sat down and smoothed the flyer on the edge of the table. He rubbed at the collar of his polo shirt.
"Do you think I need a tie? To look more presidential?"
Edgar grunted, his round face buried in some new play script. As he read, he unconsciously played with his hair, twisting and untwisting one of his loopy red curls. Elena took a swig of chocolate milk.
"What you need, Kev, is a classier look, like mine."
Elena ran her hands down her wrinkled t-shirt, which had a picture of Albert Einstein on the front. Einstein's hair shot out in all directions, in contrast to Elena's, which her abuela braided nice and tight and neat every morning before school. Kevin shook his head.
"I'm serious, Elena. Class president is an important position. I'd be able to make the school better for everyone. I could help improve our educational outcomes and experiences.
He can't just slap up a few posters and call it a campaign," an all too unwelcome voice cut in. Silver bracelets jangled on Sophina Burkhart's wrist as she reached over Kevin's shoulder and plucked up a flyer. Glittery polish flashed on her perfectly manicured nails as she brushed back a strand of her shoulder-length, straight blonde hair. Sophina's trailing pack of minions, Keisha Kilman,
Bella Ronelli Campelli, and Mandy Sykes all peered over her shoulder. This year, Kevin will actually have to earn his votes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.